welcome to this discussion, this tweespraak about myth and economics. It is organized by Uitgeverij Boom and the Soeterbeeck program. My name is Lisa Doeland. I work at the Soeterbeeck program. And I will do a small introduction to this evening. We are very honored to welcome two eminent guests, Czech economist Tomáš Sedláček and German professor of literature Josef Vogl. Tomáš Sedláček used to work as an advisor of the Czech Minister of Finance, after which he became a macroeconomist strategist for the Czech ČSOB bank. And he wrote a book that has been well written since, it was 2011, I think. You published it first in Czech, right?
That's numbers.
We'll get back to that. The importance is the title, The Economics of Good and Evil. And according to Sedláček, economy is part of culture, of philosophy, myth, religion, anthropology, and art are consequently very important, and mathematical models are never enough. The Economics of Good and Evil has become a bestseller in and outside of the Czech Republic. Josef Vogl is a professor of German literature, cultural and media studies at the Humboldt University in Berlin. And in 2010, he wrote Das Gespenst des Kapitals, The Spectre of Capital, that has been translated to Dutch as Het Spook van het Kapitaal. It has been published in January, I think. And in this book, he describes this specter of capital that determines our lives, but that we do not really understand. And he asks, why do we believe in an invisible hand of capital, of the free market? Why do we believe in the existence of a homo economicus that is very greedy? And this evening, Tomáš Sedláček and Josef Vogl will discuss the roots of economy, the status of economists as modern-day high priests, and they will talk about the importance of a fresh approach to economic science to help us out of this quagmire that is the economical crisis. However, their approach to these topics differs, whereas Sedláček argues that we need myth to understand economy, Vogl argues that the science of economy is already riddled with myth. So the question is, do we need it or not? Moderator of this discussion is Dutch journalist Koen Hagens. He's editor for the Groene Amsterdammer, and he regularly writes about the crisis, about economists and philosophers and other thinkers that analyze why this crisis has and is taking place and what we should do to overcome it. I would therefore ask you to give a warm welcome to Koen Hagens, Tomáš Sedláček and Josef Vogl.
So we start this evening with two short speeches or statements. And the first of you who is going to do that will be you, I think. So I would say, like, just start. Okay. And after that, we'll have a discussion with the two gentlemen over here. And we'll also show some short videos, because that's always really nice to see. And after that, also, we can have a discussion with all of us and ask questions and put remarks, stuff like that. But first, I would like to give the word to Tomáš with his statement.
10 minutes?
Okay. You know, he can also make half an hour. I know you. This is
save something for later this evening.
This is the problem. It's a great pleasure to be here with you. And let's try and... We have very comfortable 2 hours, so I'm looking forward for that. We've already spent a lot of time debating with each other, so I think the last will be saved for the best. I don't think, in this introduction, I don't really think there is going to be... much problem in this exact point, but let's see. In my work, I compare old myths with contemporary myths. In today's mythology, we like to use mathematics more than in the past. And of course, maybe I will just use this to give an example how economists use mythology without even knowing it, which is a little bit more dangerous than theologians, because theologians at least know that they're working with stories with certain level of probability, which I fear economists tend to forget. The way we economists employ mythology is exactly in this axiomatic logic of science, which is absolutely fine. This is how science works. We are faced up against an enemy or up against a partner which is more complicated, larger than us, reality or society. We are part of that society, and yet we try to understand it. This is, of course, we use a trick. We play as if games. This is how science works. When a physicist wants to calculate free fall, he pretends as if friction of air doesn't exist. Of course, everybody knows that friction of air exists, but it's a very useful approach. It's a very useful as if strategy. So when physicists calculates the time for the free fall, he enters a fictional world in which you have elegant mathematical formulas, which are allowed exactly because there are certain things that we delete from reality. Now, an economist is trying to mimic this, and we economists also make assumptions. So we make assumptions about human rationality. We make assumptions about egoism, etc., etc. What, in fact, economics is, and this is one of my more provocative statements, in my understanding, economics is really a moral school disguised under positivist, technical, objective-looking, scientific vehicle, so to speak. So the normativity, the, let's say, philosophical, theological, ethical, moral component in economics is hidden exactly in the word is. So when we assume that human being is rational, that's, of course, whether human beings are rational or not is a big philosophical topic. Whether human beings are egoistic or not is a huge ethical topic over which thinkers in centuries have been waging battles and quarreling, which is something that we don't like to do, so we assume it away, which is in a way fine as long as we keep this in mind. So this is how a day of an average economist look like. In the morning he wakes up and he goes and meets his colleagues and says, what shall we do today? And he said, well, let's make a model, because that seems to be a nice thing to do. How shall we start? Well, let's start with assumptions. That's always a good way to start. So what shall we assume? Well, let's assume that human beings like to jump on their left leg. Well, I don't know if that really is. Okay, let's assume that human beings like chocolate, or that they like yellow color. Now that... let's try something else. Okay, let's assume that human beings are rational. Oh, that sounds like a rational assumption. And then we assume other things as well. And we build a mathematical model on top of that, giving us results, which then we use in political persuasion of everybody else. So far, so good. The problem happens when these two economists go to the pub in the evening and engage in a philosophical conversation with their friends, telling them, you know what we discovered today? That human beings are rational, egoistic, optimizing units. Because what happened there is, in the morning, it was a technical assumption of no philosophical, ethical, and theological claim on reality. It's an assumption. We are not interested whether it is true, valid, or invalid. In the evening, it becomes a truth statement. And, you know, economists actually really engage in these debates, which is exactly how we start believing the very myths we have created ourselves in the morning. So it's a sort of a mythology. We enter a fictional world where these sort of beings exist, and we come to conclusions that normally a philosopher or theologian would perhaps come to, but we do not give it, we assume it away. So that's how economics uses mythology that we later believe in. The reason why we have these assumptions, of course, is only one. This, all these assumptions are a special purpose vehicle in order to do one thing and one thing only, and that is to be able to build a mathematical model. If we didn't have to build a mathematical model, we wouldn't actually need these all these sort of model assumptions. I was having this debate with a wonderful Dutch thinker, Joris, and what's his surname? It's a very Dutch surname.
Lion.
Yes, that. And I'm sorry, we also have very nasty surnames such as mine. And I was having a similar debate like I had the honor of having with you today, and I said, you know, so it's like, you know, economists become, economics becomes blind leading the blind. And he looked at me and he says, no, that's too optimistic. And I said, well, what do you mean? And he said, well, you know, the blind knows that he or she is blind. Our situation is worse. We are not aware of the fact that we are, in fact, blind. And this, I think, is a good point. So I will conclude with sort of a working conclusion that we talked about today, that economists should be treated like any religious minority. They should have the right to believe whatever they want to believe and confess it freely and have space to meet. But, of course, always when you meet one, you should go like, okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Thomas here already mentioned that the two gentlemen here have already talked for 3 hours today, but that was not for nothing, because there will come a little booklet about this discussion that we all probably can read and buy in a few months. I hope so.
We hope so.
Yes. And still, they will have a nice discussion here today, tonight also,
can't
and say
enough
new things even. Still discovering each other. So, after this, Josef Vogl, can
thanks,
I give you the word?
Thanks, Thomas. And we not only had 3 hours of discussion, but we also drank wine. And,
yes,
you know, he's a Czech. He's a Czech and doesn't need notes when he speaks and having drank wine. So I need some notes. Please excuse this
okay.
National problem of a German. But we have a second problem. I was told to disagree.
Huh.
I don't disagree.
Ah. We'll come to that later.
what are I doing now? So we can stop here. And I can try to say I partly disagree.
Oh,
yeah?
good,
partly
good.
Disagree.
this close.
yes. No, and I think it's very important that our economic knowledge, which is the knowledge of capitalism in a certain sense, this economic knowledge needs stories, legends, needs myth in a certain way. And we have a lot of economical myths or legends or stories which crowd our economical thinking. Think about, for example, one of the most famous legends or stories. It's Robinson Crusoe, yeah? The self-made man on his island, creating his own universe, creating his own economic microcosmos. Another economical myth is the so-called village market. You know? You have a village market, an idyllic place, you exchange goods, and even complex economics function like a village market. There's another very famous myth, it's a myth of the entrepreneur, for example, which always seeks innovation, which makes something which is called creative destruction, which is the motor of progress. And we have also dark myths, or black myths, like, for example, the usurer, the greedy Jew, which destroys good Christian businesses.
Yes.
These are all myths which populates our imagination and which helps us in a certain way to navigate through our complex economic system. But I think, so we can make a sort of encyclopedia of these myths or legends, which would be an interesting, an interesting project. But I wanted to make a completely different point which joins your argument. And when I myself talked about the necessity to secularize economics, to make economic thinking more earthly in a certain way, my thesis was or is the following. Modern theories of the market have a theological, have a religious and even monotheist heritage. They are inspired by the government of a charming, almighty and even providential God. Let me briefly explain. From Adam Smith's Invisible Hand, as you know, up to the idea of efficient markets today, up to the idea of efficient financial markets, we can realize that in the core of these theories, a wonderful or magic mechanism is working. The mechanism shows us that chaotic, selfish, egoistic activities turn into something like social order or social harmony. What does this mean? And I would like to make 5 points to characterize this thesis. First point. Since the 18th century, markets and market mechanisms are imagined as a machine which creates or produces equilibrium. This is important. Equilibrium. Behind or...
What? Writing it down.
Okay. Cheers.
Cheers. Please continue.
Let's try to be serious. Okay. Once more. Yeah, ready?
I already have
okay. So markets have a tendency towards equilibrium behind or underneath the visible chaos of the world, the chaos of interests, passions, etc. There is an invisible mechanism working which transforms all this disaster into welfare, into something like a common good. Second, this equilibrium or this balance is the core element of a liberal economic or market theories, and especially this is the reason for the what I will call the physicalism of these theories. In the 18th century, for example, markets were imagined like Newtonian physics, physics of gravitation. In the 19th century, it was thermodynamics, and in the 20th century, it is stochastics, the model, the mathematical, physical model of this equilibrium. This means that the progredient mathematization of economic theory follows the idea that market, and especially financial markets, have an inherent tendency towards equilibrium. Strange idea. Third, this also means that the markets achieve or actualize a providential scheme or a providential hope. Whatever may happen, all the catastrophes, crashes, accidents, boosts and busts don't witness against the felicitous effects of the market. Let them work, let markets work, don't intervene, don't disturb them, and all will be fine. This is, and this I think is important, this is the heritage of the old idea of theodicy. All the mundane, all the earthly disasters, illnesses, wars, etc., aren't an argument against the wise and providential actions of God. I call this in my book eco-DC or eco-DC, the markets still are the best of all possible worlds. Fourth, in this conception, and here I join your argument, there is also a moral advantage, an advantage in moral philosophy. By the way, Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations, this famous book, was written as a second volume of moral philosophy. The moral advantage is the following. Only markets guarantee something like distributive justice. The market represents natural laws. Follow these laws and a fair and just distribution of all goods will become real. And last point, which I wanted to make here, and this is finally the reason why the markets are telling us always the truth. You want to make a new institution or a new law? Ask the markets. You want to change policy? Listen what markets are telling you. You want to be a good politician? So trust the wisdom of the market. This is, I think, the religious, the theological, the monotheistic heritage of modern economic thinking. Equilibrium, physicalism, providence, justice, and the voice of the truth. Markets are the last resort and the last residues of our faith or our belief. And this, I think, is one of the most greatest, the most fatal errors in history of sciences. We have to begin to think markets without God.
Thank you. Thank you both for your statement. Really clear, actually, and indeed there doesn't seem to be any disagreement here. But let's go further on this shortly on these myths, because it's both in your interesting books. It's an important topic. You seem to want to debunk all these myths. You mentioned them, equilibrium, markets, especially the invisible hand. Meanwhile, you all also say these are a myth, but you do something also interesting, namely you point at history and you see in different myths in history, you see already signs of a, for example, this invisible hand, even at the Gilgamesh epos 4,000 years ago. That's quite a long time.
yes. And you can see this even in theology, in which actually the whole idea of plowing with the devil, that you are allowed to use egoism to employ it to bring out good, is something that in theology you see actually quite frequently. But that's not the topic of now. Let me give another example of this wonderful myth of the invisible hand of the market. As you said, the principle of the invisible hand of the market is I, as an individual, want to perform an egoistic act, and I want to win some profit. And what economic as a moral school tells me is I shouldn't care about the impacts on the society, because there is this thing that will take care of it and dwarf it to good. So I want to do evil, but damn it, I did it again. It turned it into good. This, this is exactly the reverse of what Paul talks about in the letter to Romans. I want to do good, but damn it, I end up doing evil.
He didn't say damn it, huh?
No, he said something else. In the Czech
Jesus, he said. Jesus.
Yeah. So you have this. So this is, for example, a nice. Nice way of also, the reverse way of using mythology is when you are immersed in a myth, facts appear. It's not that facts support a theory, theory creates these facts. A stupid example, for example, GDP. Yeah, this is a very big number, holy of holies in economics. And it seems to be a very solid, hard fact. But Why do we measure GDP in national terms, for example? This, you could argue, is a remnant of nationalism. Why don't we measure GDP in regional terms? If we did that, we would discover that some regions of Greece would be supporting some regions of Germany. Definitely there are richer regions in Greece than there are some regions in especially Eastern Germany.
May I say something? Just a little remark. We in Germany, we made a big progress in the last week because Germany decided to integrate the mafia, the black market and the drug markets into the GDP.
Yeah. So but your GDP jumped.
First in the world.
Yeah. I think it was a European-wide measure. Because Holland has also expanded hugely.
Yeah.
Because of the drugs.
And does anybody have a tissue for my nose? Thank you. So you can see that if we measure GDP in regional terms, the whole discourse would immediately change. And this whole after Second World War remnant sorry, some things are better outside than inside. Or let's just take an even crazier example. Of course, the reality remains the same, but we choose different things to measure, and the debate becomes completely, completely different. It would lose this nationalistic Second World War remnant, who did what to who 50 years ago. Let's just for a second imagine that we would measure the GDP of women versus men. Why not? So how would our newspaper articles look like? Well, the GDP of women went up by 4.2% in 2013, while the GDP of males decreased by 2.4. Now, should the women be solidary with these always lazy men and do fiscal transfers? And how long will this last? We should maybe come up with laws that should, you know, put some incentives for males to work harder. And this, of course, is laughable because it's a crazy example, and I agree, but why is it more crazy than measuring GDP in national terms? So you can see that the selection, as objective as you want to be, is already historically, for reasons that we don't have to go to, predetermined by measuring it nationally. When it comes to, if I may react to this equilibrium thing, we believe that the economy goes in cycles. Well, maybe it doesn't go in cycles, maybe it's like a tangent. It goes to an extreme, and then it comes back again. So the curve is not continuous, but it's like a tangent curve, going to from minus infinity to infinity. But the government blocks it down, so from distance, it looks like a smooth sine curve. You could see this quite nicely in, for example, 2008. If it wouldn't have been for the government intervention, the economy would probably, most likely, collapse. So, for example, maybe I will shock you, but I believe in the invisible hand, but not of the market, but of the society. The society, for some reasons, has a self-corrective mechanism. So when one body of the society goes crazy, another body corrects it. So this time, the body of economics went crazy, and the body of politics corrected it. When the society becomes too bureaucratic, a generation of hippies corrects it. When or Kafka is born. And you can see that sometimes the economy, business, saves the government. Sometimes it's the artistic world that saves theology. So there is some regulating mechanism of a society. The question that I have, if this is something that's acceptable, how could it be that we have privatized this regulating mechanism to the wonderful workings of the economy alone? That, to me, is the real question.
So you say the invisible hand, it exists. It existed through whole history, but we narrowed it down to only economics.
Yes, in a way. And to add one argument to your fuel, I think the economy pretends to be an objective arbiter of values, not telling you anything. In fact, exactly the opposite is true. I think one way how to describe the markets would be an unorchestrated orchestrator. You are not allowed to orchestrate it. This is the famous laissez-faire, laissez-passer. Do not touch it, let it be, let it work. And don't meddle. And by, if you need to meddle, by no chance meddle ethically. It will tell you what to do. It will tell you the values. It will tell you that being an egoist is okay. It will tell you that you don't have to worry about the impact of your consequence, the consequences of your doings. It will tell you all these highly moral schools. So I think we properly really should consider economics to be a moral school, which is okay, of course. But it shouldn't be disguised in a taboo territory, where which works as a debate stopper, because that's to me is the inconsistency. You don't debate it because it's an assumption, but it, in fact it isn't an assumption. It's a truth statement. It's a value statement. So anyway.
Yes. This. Let me expand a bit on this and then ask you a question, because this seems to be this critic on the economy that it has to open up, that it has to listen to different disciplines, that seems to be a rising for the last years, doesn't it? Because you are saying like it has to be a part of a bigger body of thought. And what do we see at this moment? All kinds of different disciplines, theologists, sociologists are starting to engage with economy anew. Do you see that too? Or aren't you so positive?
No, I'm actually very positive. I think it's a wonderful time to be an economist, because economics of all the humanities is going through repentance. You know, we did something wrong. We believed something that obviously we shouldn't have believed. Here I would use the very beautiful line from or title of a book by Nietzsche, human so human. You know, anything that we human beings create, be it computer, car, or a chair, we don't expect that to be perfect, because it was made by human beings for human beings. And with one exception, and that's economics. Economics has, if you have noticed, even godlike properties. It is omniscient, it is omnipresent, it has more intelligence than the sum of its players, and it can see into the future. No other field of humanities, even of any science, meddles so readily with future like economics. I mean, try to ask a sociologist, well, when will racism end in, I don't know, Czech Republic or in Netherlands or anywhere else? If the sociologist would be trained in a similar way like an economist, he or she would say, oh yes, thank you for a beautiful question. We estimate racism to end 15th of July 2021. political scientists will never, you know, speak so readily. Even a lawyer, lawyers don't even know how a single case will end up. But economists are always so readily future-looking, which I think is not only stupid, but it's actually very dangerous, because in the situation of uncertainty, you are simulating and pretending that you actually know where you're going, which then makes your movements much faster. It's like sitting in a car that doesn't have brakes.
Let me ask Joseph, because...
Let me just make a remark to what Tomáš said. I think this is a very important point, that modern economists always think the end of history. So when economic is functioning, when markets are functioning, especially when financial markets are functioning, there is no history at all. And the golden age of the financial markets were in the 90s, and in the 90s, Fukuyama published his book on the end of history. And I think the problem economists have now, in a certain way, to think, for example, heterodox economics, is to reintegrate history, and this means uncertainty, unexpected. expected events, etc., in economic thinking. This is completely strange to the thinking of economic systems or economic models.
Heterodox economics is all the different alternative
occurrence
within the non-Catholic. Yeah, that's beautiful said.
So it's very difficult for economists, I think so, you are economists, it's very difficult for economists to rethink economic dynamics as historical dynamics and not as quasi-natural dynamics, which are in a certain way stable. First point. I wanted to add a second point, another aspect. When economics were founded in the 18th century, when some theologians and jurists discovered something like the economic event or the economic unit, whatever, it was not so much the interest of to describe exchange, business, etc., but it was linked to the idea that with the market we have a better instrument to govern society. So the markets are not economically interesting, they are interesting because they exercise a certain discipline to the subject, they organize society, they are an instrument of government. I think this is the birth, the origin of economic thinking, not describing economic mechanisms, but inventing mechanisms, instruments for better governing society.
This order also is what makes it so attractive.
Exactly.
You think that too? Is that the main reason? Because you've both now criticized a lot of economics that it's untrue, it's arrogant,
no,
especially.
No, it's not true. It, just because it's mythical doesn't mean that it's not true.
It has become true.
No, well, Sollust, who is a pre-Socratic philosopher, defined myth in the following way. Myth is something that never happened, but it's happening always. You know? And so when you talk about Adam and Eve, it doesn't really, really, really matter whether Adam has an ID with 001 and Eve has an ID with 002. What's important is that this story somehow, till today, we can relate to it and we use it to explain certain things. So just because it's symbolic doesn't mean that it's not real. I would even say that symbolic is more real than the real itself. This is really how build on your point, we have real history somewhere here, which is a sort of a shadow land. This is sort of, but the real, this is just a manifestation, but the real, the truth, is some mathematical formula which manifests itself somehow in the history, but the underlying symbol is constant. With which I'm fine. I think economics also, you know, gave us a huge progress, etc., etc. We shouldn't be bang bashing it, but we should really treat it as sometimes useful, sometimes dangerous mythology, not as objective truth that we can rely on. We cannot rely on economics to be guiding us the way we have in the past. That's maybe my point.
Mm-hmm. And I think you can get one step further. You can say economic thinking, which school ever, economic thinking is an interpretation of social relations or social phenomenon, but only one interpretation. There are other interpretations.
Yes.
And I think this was the big discovery of Karl Marx. Karl Marx was the first who discovered something like the commodity as an interpretation of social relationships. And you must interpret this interpretation in a certain way. Modern economists forgot that this is an option. This is one of several alternatives, and it's a sort of hermeneutics. Yeah? So you make social hermeneutics if you build economic models.
Yeah. So maybe one way how I could put this, you know, that there is analytic philosophy. It's like saying that analytic philosophy is the only approach to life. Analytic philosophy is a legitimate subset of philosophy, but we know that we have other philosophical schools as well. And that's how I think we should treat analytical or mathematical economics as one. In certain aspects, I think it's useful to use mathematics. Mm-hmm. But we must also understand that in certain aspects it's impossible to use mathematics. Mm. In other words, nice way how I picture this for myself is that in life we have very many values. Some of those values have a number, price. Some of those values do not have a number. And that's fine, doesn't mean that one is better. Okay, so for example, this has a price, this has a price, this has a price. Some things do not have a price. So no matter how good your mathematics is, your results, even if your mathematics would be perfect, your results will always be leaping on one leg because you can never put all the values into the equation. It's like asking for the price of a dinner if you don't know what's the price of the main course. You can have a very exact calculation of the drinks and the side orders, but you can never have a proper picture. And this is what we should know. We should have arm's length distance from the numbers. One other way how we create this mythology is by this image of rigorousness. So we try to create rigorous models. So I say, fine, but if you want to be rigorous, then you must be or should be rigorous all the way. In other words, with every assumption, give it a probability. So let's make an assumption that human beings are, now I'm simplifying a little bit, but let's have an assumption that human beings can order their preferences. So let's say that's 80% likely. So the model that I'm working on now, I'm working on 80% probability scheme. Another assumption is that human beings maximize their utility, which of course also isn't given. So let's say that's 50-50. So now I'm already 40% probability. And before I come to the place where I can even build the huge model, I am now living on a 5% probability scheme. That's how we should treat our models. They're 5% or whatever, 25%. This is not important. What's important is that they're not 100% representation of reality. This, I think, is a frequent mistake that we make.
Yeah. I would like to, at this point, to go to a short video fragment from the movie Cosmopolis, based on the novel. And Josef Vogel mentioned it at the start of his book, this also as a story about not just the normal economy, but about the financial markets. And actually, it's a story, an unstory, because it shows that it hardly can be told, I think. But maybe we watch this first fragment. I have to click it. And then after that, you can explain why you choose this one, this book, to start your story with.
Under the assumption that the video works.
Yeah, well.
But we can just assume it, and we are fine.
What do we do about this?
Let it express itself.
What? Do nothing.
Let it express itself. You can stand up now.
So look, we have two rumors working in our favor. First, there's the bankruptcies for 6 straight months. More each month, more on the way. Large Chinese corporations. This is good.
Yuan will drop.
This is loss of faith. It will force the yuan to drop.
The dollar will settle up.
The yuan will drop. Where's Chin?
Working on visual patterns.
This thing doesn't chart.
It charts.
It doesn't chart the way you chart technology stocks. You can find real patterns there, locate predictable components. This is different.
We're teaching him to see.
You should do the scene. You're the seer. What is he? He's a kid. He's got the streak in his hair. He's got the earring.
He doesn't have the earring.
If he was any dreamier, we'd have to put him on life support.
What's the second rumor?
There's a rumor, it seems, involving the finance minister. Some kind of scandal about a misconstrued comment. He made a comment about the economy that may have been misconstrued. The whole country is now analyzing the grammar and syntax of this comment. Or wasn't even what he said. It was when he paused. They're trying to construe the meaning of the pause. So it may be deeper, even, than grammar. He may be breathing. So the whole economy convulses because the man took a breath.
You gripped the water bottle.
It's that soft tape plastic.
You grip it. You choke it.
it's a matter of fact thing.
It's sexual tension.
It's everyday nervousness in a
life. It's sexual tension. Days like this.
What?
Oh, that whole sad business of Judeo-Christian jogging. You were not born to run. I look at you, I know what you are. You're sloppy-bodied, smelly, and wet. A woman who was born to sit strapped in a chair while a man tells her how much she excites him.
How come we've never spent this kind of time together?
Your prostate is asymmetrical.
Okay, that was pretty fake stuff. Maybe Joseph, you can tell what did we see here, except for prostate research.
I only saw Dutch subtitles. So sorry for that. What is interesting in this figure called Eric Pecker, who is a broker, who is a hedge fund manager. Interesting in this film, but especially in the novel, is that he is a figure, sort of allegory of financial capital, which wants to leave reality, which wants to leave Earth, which wants to leave past and present and project himself in the future. This means to gain a sort of suspended existence, which does no longer touch past, present, and reality. This is the dream of capital at the beginning of the novel. Second, it's very interesting, all the novel happens in this car, and this car is like the ship of Odysseus. It's a sort of odyssey, also following the American dream. This means from the east to the west, go west. Yeah? And third, this novel ends in death and shows that in the structure of capital, in the structure of financial capital, there's a certain kind of death drive. Leaving the world means also gaining only a spiritual existence which is equal to death. So these are some points which were very interesting for me, but at last, and this is the problem of telling tales or telling stories about capital, how can you really show something, how can you narrate something which is completely unintuitive, something like the work of a stock exchange, something like the digital markets. You can't really tell them, you can't narrate them. This is the big problem at the center of this novel. How can you tell something which is not visible, which is not touchable, which is a spiritual, only spiritual business. So these were the points which me interested in with respect of this novel.
Is it just something of the financial world, financial economics, yeah, or is it for all of economics?
No, I think it's very important that here we are dealing with financial economics, which started in this universe in the 70s. No? It's a very new world. Sociologues say that financial economics or financial economists, brokers, etc., live in a time-based world, no longer in a space-based world. Yeah? Wherever you exist, if you sit in New York or in London or Singapore or in Frankfurt, this doesn't matter. It matters only time links, time-critical processes. And this is very interesting that we have a certain class of people who no longer exist in spatially world, in here and now, but only in a time-based world, which is oriented only very in the direction of the future. And this is the problem of the story by Don DeLillo. Telling events which happen only in time and not in space.
Tomáš, you work for a big bank. You sit often in cars like that, talking like that.
No. But I used to sit in the open office in trading, so a little bit more people, but not in cars. Mm-hmm.
What do you think about this difference that's being made, especially for the last 5-6 years, between, like, you have a real economy, you know, where things are produced, things I can touch, and you have this virtual financial economy, and that also said that the laws for this second economy, the financial economy, are completely different than the normal economic laws. What do you think about this polarization, actually?
You know, you see this actually. Let's go into theoretical physics. I mean, logic of one level of reality, let's say the Newtonian space, is completely contraintuitive with the logic of the quantum space. There, contraintuitive things happen on regular basis. You know, particles traveling against the flow of time. One photon being at two places at the same time. You know, having interaction with each other. This is absolutely contraintuitive from a Newtonian experience. The same is true theory of relativity. Again, extremely contraintuitive, even very difficult to understand. Here, mathematics, to its defense, is extremely useful because we cannot go into these places without mathematics. This is only These spaces are only accessible with the level of completely contraintuitive mathematics. In other words, on every space of reality, now I'm talking about physical reality, there is different logic guarding the behavior of the real. So the fact that this is impossible to be connected is, of course, a known problem from physics. This is, of course, the famous Feynman quest for the theory of everything. Interesting that this has never been attempted even in social sciences. If you've ever heard of such an effort, please correct me, but to my knowledge, there's never ever been an attempt to come up with a theory of everything. To connect sociology with psychology, with law, with economics, with politics, with, you know, media studies. This would be something that would be extremely useful, because this was the method of Renaissance, that we divide the reality into small fractions and then we come together and we glue, so to speak, the particles together. But this is impossible because every field is guarded by different logic, different rules. To make matters even worse, I would even say this is fundamentally impossible, because you see the same logic working in the very heart of the most abstract of all human endeavors, which is mathematics. You are, of course, familiar with the Kurt Gödel's incompleteness theorem, in which he has proved that if you have an axiomatic structure, you cannot prove certain things which are intuitively true. We know this thing must be the case, but there is, from these axioms, we cannot reach to formally prove that. If we enlarge the axiomatic base, so to speak, then we will come to paradoxes. If the axiomatic base is too large, then we come to conclusion that A equals non-A, which is impossible. So even in mathematics, you need to choose a special horses for courses, a special toolbox, depending on what sort of problems you want to solve. So this, I think, is normal. This is a little joke. I don't know if you say this in this beautiful country as well, but in my country language, we often say, you know, it works in theory, but it doesn't work in practice. You know, so theoretically, I can, you know,
yeah,
whatever, but in practice, it doesn't work. What's much more common is exactly the opposite. It works in practice, but it doesn't work in theory.
And that counts for the financial sector.
No, but it counts even for physical reality. Even today's physics is full of paradoxes, or, you know, in economics, paradoxes that are impossible to unite. If there would be one such paradox in the real, in practical, the universe would disassemble immediately. It would collapse. But obviously, it's functioning. So it works in practice. Things fall down. Society works. Somehow people, you know, trade. But it doesn't work in theory. Our understanding is incomplete. We don't fully understand. So the problem is in theory. The problem isn't so much in the real. The problem is in our understanding. So this I would not hold against economics. This is a common trait even in mathematics, that there are different rules of logic which cannot be connected.
But, yeah. But may I answer the question?
Yes.
Okay. So the question was how real, so-called real economics and financial economics are, do they correspond or do they not? And I would say, naturally, they correspond, they are the same thing. You are here in Amsterdam is a good place to talk about it.
Tomorrow we're in Amsterdam.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Sorry.
But
in Netherlands. I would say Netherlands.
Ah, you did it.
No. So we are talking about capitalism, and capitalism is always financial capitalism. This means accumulation of capital, credit, and investment. And since the 17th century, so since the Netherlands in the 18th century, we can talk about capitalist structures. I think we can see that financial economy and financial markets, with a huge idea of gains, have immediate impact on real economies. For example, displacing labor to other countries, for example, to reorganize industrial structures, to ask industry to have the same gains as financial markets. And we see that especially financial markets are now the motor of modernization of all other economic fields, uh-huh. Industry, commodities, whatever, even universities.
But still, there are schools like, for example, the Nobel Prize winner Robert Shiller, who make this difference. They say like the certain laws also of equilibrium, they work for a normal economy, but as soon as you have this financial economy, then the normal, for example, that demand
supply.
Thank you. The demand and supply are more or less in equilibrium. It works for normal economy. It doesn't work for financial economy.
Yeah, this is the old thesis of Keynes, of Maynard Keynes, and there's another famous scholar, another famous student of Keynes, Hyman Minsky, who is the only one who develops a theory of instability of financial markets. And the theorem or the thesis is very simple. If stock prices go up, you have to buy and not to sell. It's completely
which
the other way
around. Which would be normal for milk, for example, a bottle of milk.
And so you have the so-called positive feedback catastrophes. So it's very rational to buy when prices go up. In all other markets, it's reasonable to sell.
Yeah. One last question, and then I would suggest to go to a second little fragment. But you already mentioned here, you mentioned Keynes, you mentioned Hyman Minsky, who you also write about in your book. There is this lots of criticism on economics, but still economists say like, the differences within economics is much broader than that. Nowadays it's popular to talk about neoclassical economics, and it seems that it's like a whole big pile of rotten economics and there is nothing else. But these economists say like there are so many different other currents and thoughts and self-criticism also. Sure. Isn't it a bit rude to treat economics like this?
Well, the way we teach economics is when a neophyte comes to and wants to join our herd, we will brainwash him for 3 to 4 years. A good example is, for example, gift. This was something that was already used, also wonderfully treated in David Graeber's book, Debt, a History. So, in the world of economics, gift is a paradox, because yet another example. Every textbook starts with this thing, there is nothing like a free lunch. Yeah, this is very common. What do you mean there's nothing like free lunch? I've had many, I mean, theologians would definitely disagree. I mean, the whole Christianity is based on this, that there is actually a free lunch, you know. Sociology would disagree, anthropology would disagree. I mean, you could go and talk about this forever, but economists simply, you know, how to put it in a politely, well, they just state it and period. I mean, there is nothing like a free lunch. So, of course, you are 16 or 18, whatever. Oh, okay, so, of course, yeah, there is nothing like a free lunch. The world is cynical. Nobody's going to give you anything for free. And anything that looks as a gift is really a way to exploit you, misuse you later, blah, 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 blah. 10 pages later, they come up with, you know, human beings are egoistic. If you remember, aha, no such thing as a free lunch, that makes sense. And you go along the flow until you are fully embedded in this. And then suddenly, in the third year, they tell you, but there is this paradox called giving. So you are driving in a foreign country, you stop at a motorway restaurant, a waitress comes to you and you give her tips. Why? You're never gonna come back. And there is, you know, she's already given you the food, she's not gonna spit on it if you don't give her any tips. This is a huge paradox. Yes, it's a paradox, but only to economists. To normal people, yeah, of course we give tips. I mean, this is not a problem, it's just a habit, it's a nice way, blah, 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 blah. But to an economist who's been trained to, or brainwashed, whatever you want to call this, for 3 years that human beings are egoistic, they don't do any, there's no such thing as a free lunch, tips don't exist, in other words. Yeah, you know, you can break your head going like, oh my God, yeah, these gifts, it's
And when comes the change, or does it never come when you study economics?
Well, you can go, there's ways of ignoring this. And well, this is actually how we teach our students, you know, to become an expert economist is to close your eye to the wide real. But this also happens in other sciences as well. But not so. This I think is the difference. Philosophy, sociology, every field that we teach starts with teaching history, not so that you know dates, but so that the students understand that what we think now is the holy truth is just one of the theories. That's why when we teach philosophy, we go very meticulously that, you know, 2,000 years ago, people thought that, I don't know what, ideas, then came Aristotle, completely flipped it upside down, then came somebody else, flipped it again, blah, 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 blah. And now, today, we happen to think something else. But please have distance from your sociological theories, from your philosophical theories, from your even theological theories. In economics, we do it completely the other way around. First, we teach them the truth, which is this the neoclassical synthesis. And then when the faith of these neophytes is strong enough, we tell them about other religions as well, but for fun. Don't believe it, but there's also Buddhism, you know, ha ha ha. And then there is also Judaism, ha ha ha, you know, and blah, blah, blah. But of course, rest assured that this is just a nuisance.
You studied economics, but what went wrong with you?
I had a very good
You didn't attend, or
good teacher, yeah. The problem is because economics has become so embedded in politics, we and this in a way again I would use as an advocacy, we don't have time to philosophize. Politician comes and asks us, should I increase or decrease interest rate? Mm-hmm. And we have to come up with an answer, which is something that sociologists or theologians are not, or philosophers not at all, are not faced with. So this is what drives, and we also talked about this, how in France they have this separation of church and state. We should also think about, you know, the separation of economics and state. But, you know.
Yeah, that's good. Joseph?
Simply an episode, because it's really serious what you're saying now.
That's serious.
Thank you so much. Demonstration of gift, which doesn't own him.
Yes, exactly.
simply episode. So at Humboldt University in Berlin, students of economics founded a new sort of circle of pluralist economics, because they thought they do not want to be taught only in the one with the one truth.
I hope they kick them out.
And it's very so. This was published, And the chair of the department wrote to the students, they have to stop it. They blame the discipline. And if they do not want to make economics, they leave the discipline. And this is, I do not know any other discipline in which police-like actions like this could
So the students said, we want to know more.
Yeah, exactly. So we want to read Minsky, we want to read again Keynes, or we want even to read Marx. Yeah. And this was explicitly forbidden. Yeah.
This you can nicely see in another textbook example. So Samuelson, you know, has been sort of the Bible of economics since 50s. It's an interesting book. In the beginning, Paul Samuelson writes, the point of this book is to teach you to think like an economist. So immediately, you think, okay, fine, which one? You do mean Minsky, or you mean Keynes, or you mean Marx, or you mean Hayek, or you mean Friedman, or you mean, who do you mean? Surely, if you put all these great economists in one room, the one and only thing they would not agree is on Samuelson. Mm. Definitely not. Yeah. You know, this is not an average, weighted average of the opinion between, I don't know, Hayek and Friedman, or somebody else. So, surely, you don't mean to say that I want you to think like I think, which is in fact what Paul Samuelson does. The point of that book is for you to think like I think. But it's even worse, I think, if we wanted to be really meticulously detailed, what the proper reading of that sentence should be, I will teach you to believe like I believe. To believe that human beings are approximatable by mathematical, that human beings are actually egoists, that human beings da-di-da-di-da-di-da. That's what is taught in schools of economics. This is what's happening. And this, of course, then is a problem because it becomes an extremely closed discipline.
If it's that bad, you also say it has to come from outside. From literature, for example, or a media scientist.
Well, for the starter, I think I absolutely agree with you. Mm. It would be just enough if we actually read The Economist, not just, you know, two or three. Mm. If we read Minsky, if we read Derrida McCloskey, if we read even Hayek, Hayek would completely disagree with this mathematical approach. Or the German statistical school, that also completely disagree. But this is something that we are only taught as a curiosity.
Start reading. Okay. The next fragment is from another movie, not Cosmopolis, but Margin Call. That's actually a really sober movie, I thought. It's about this investment firm. It's on the brink of the big crisis. They discover somebody, a newbie, discovers that they have lots of toxic assets. And they decide to do something with these, namely before the rest of the market finds out, sell everything. And that's actually a daring choice, because when they sell everything, they don't maybe won't have a problem, but the rest of capitalism will have. And the scene you see is right after that. So they succeeded, they sold almost everything they had, but at the same time, they know, you know, the big crisis started because they flooded the market with toxic assets. Well, let's see this.
Sam, please sit. Congratulations are clearly in order.
They did the best they could.
You did a hell of a job, and I thank you for it. Come on, sit. Excuse me for eating, but it's been a long day. Can I get you something?
No, nothing, thanks.
So, what can I do for you?
I want out. I'm done. I want out.
It's been a very difficult day.
I need you to release my options. If they're worth anything after today, I want my bonus, I'm out.
You'll get your bonus, your options, and keep your current base, but I need you to stay with me for the next 24 months, okay? Oh, come on. Come on, Sam. Put a smile on your face. You did some good today. You said that yourself. Do you know, I'm starting to feel a little better about this whole thing. You're one of the luckiest guys in the world, Sam. Could have been digging ditches all these years.
That's true. And if I had, at least there'd be some holes in the ground to show for it. I just don't know how we fucked this up quite so much.
When did you start feeling so sorry for yourself? It's unbearable. What? So you think we might have put a few people out of business today? That's all for naught. But you've been doing that every day for almost 40 years, Sam. And if this is all for naught, then so is everything out there. It's just money. It's made up. Pieces of paper with pictures on it so we don't have to kill each other just to get something to eat. It's not wrong. And it's certainly no different today than it's ever been. 1637, 1797, 1819, 37, 57, 84, 1901, 07, 29, 1937, 1974, 1987. Jesus, didn't that fucker fuck me up good? 92, 97, 2000, and whatever we want to call this. It's all just the same thing over and over. We can't help ourselves. And you and I can't control it or stop it or even slow it. We even ever so slightly alter it. We just react. And we make a lot of money if we get it right. And we get left by the side of the road if we get it wrong. And there have always been and there always will be the same percentage of winners and losers, happy fucks and sad sacks, fat cats and starving dogs in this world. Yeah. There may be more of us today than there's ever been, but the percentages, they stay exactly the same.
I'll do it, John, but not because of your little speech, but because I need the money. Hard to believe after all these years, but I need the money.
Executive, do
you want coffee or tea? No. You
gonna keep the kid? Keep him. He's getting promoted. It's all hands on deck now, Sam. There's going to be a lot of money to be made coming out of this mess, and we're going to need all the brains we can get around here.
They're going to make a lot of money with the mess. That's cynical as hell, isn't it?
I like it and I dislike it in a certain way. What's interesting in this scene is that you have an impression, and the broker is telling you, have an impression that financial crises are quite regular. They happen all seven or eight or nine or 10 years. So it's not something unexpected. First, what I dislike in films like that, but also, for example, The Wolf of Wall Street or Wall Street by Oliver Stone, they give us an image of financial markets which are reigned by greed and by criminal subjects in a certain way. And this is not true. The most of the business is legal. Most of the business is carried out by completely normal bourgeois men. I have the impression that films like this create the picture of the evil of financial markets and don't lead us to a clear analysis of this market, of their regular functioning. The regular functioning is of a threat, not these few criminals or rogue brokers or whatever. So the regular functioning, the legal functioning of these markets is the problem, and not greed, and not these figures as shown here. So this is the problem with these films.
Tomáš?
So
it's getting late.
No. On the contrary, I think what I, you know, I have a son who's 7 years old, so I had the privilege of seeing all these movies with him for the children, and now there's this big movie, Lego Story, right? And the main villain in that Lego Story is called Mr. Business, you know, which I think is going a little bit already, you know, too far. On the question of these collapses, I was just talking about this in the afternoon today with the philosophers, theologians, and religious studies, about the year of Jubilee, where in the Old Testament they would reset the system every 49 years. And I was having this mental exercise of what's the best system and how do actually systems work, and that the most ideal system that we know of is a computer program. That's a mathematical 0-1, absolutely predictable, human design, perfect, 100% of human engineering. It's a dream of a scientist to be able to describe the functioning of a society like we can describe the functioning of a computer program. Yet, even these perfect systems freeze. So even a computer program freezes. Even if you have an apple, it freezes from time to time. That means no system, even if that system is computer program perfect, can go on forever. Like a car does not run forever because it's human, so human. Again, coming back to Nietzsche. So even if our society would be as the social system would be as perfect as a computer program, even without money, even without banks, people paying each other with smiles or something. Even that system, a complete kibbutz with hippies all over the place, even that system would collapse from time to time. It would go in through these singularities. What my suggestion is, of course, yes, we as people who are interested, we should try and devote a lot of energy into trying to make the system as non-collapsing as possible, but we should know that it's impossible to make a perfectly non-collapsing system. So a part of our energy, our mental energy, should be, and this is, again, a second topic that has not happened in social sciences, again, to my knowledge, I could be wrong, I haven't read everything, but a huge part of our energy should be actually devoted exactly what to do when the system collapses, because it will collapse. And there is no thinking done whatsoever when what to do when actually the system... Just imagine every time your computer freezes, you would have to cut off your finger or something. That's how the society is structured right now. You know, from time to time, the system freezes and the clever ones win on it, and the some other part of the society experience pain. And it is exactly the question, it is exactly our task, and this I think is a new task of humanities and social sciences, is to devote some energy, what to do, how to produce it when things like this happen, so that the reset is done in a fair way, which is exactly sort of the meaning of the year of Jubilee. Once in a while, we reset the system, we start again, and the social transfer will go from the rich to the poor.
So because debts are forgiven.
Everybody returns the property to the original owners, and debts and debt slaves that could not be paid were forgiven. So the social transfer was from up down. Whereas in these cases, it usually in a super sophisticated society that has hundreds of thousands of economists using very sophisticated mathematical bazookas, still, we cannot think of a systemic reset which would at least randomly resemble fairness.
Yeah. We just had this reset, this collapse. What would you suggest to do right now?
Let me add one thing, because the problem is not the crash. The problem is the reset. Mm-hmm. And the problem is that after the reset, you have a completely different redistribution of wealth and riches. So
completely unorganized, chaotic.
And this is important. So this was the crisis of 1987, 1919, as mentioned here, 1992, 1998, Russian crisis, 2000 dot-com bubble, and 2008. And what was the result of all this crisis? And why don't this crisis, why don't they harm the system? Because the richer became, after the rich, crisis, much more richer. Yeah? So you have a statistics, it's American consulting corporation, Capgemini. They made statistic that 2010, worldwide, we have more millionaires than 2007. 2011, we have worldwide more capital in the hands of these millionaires than 2007. In 2011, 70 million people fell under the absolute poverty limit. So the poor get poor, and the richer get richer. And this is the effect of this crisis.
Yeah.
So the problem is not the crisis, the problem is the restart.
Yeah. That's a nice one.
So it is not in the interest of the financial sector to really find cure, because as they said beautifully, we can make a lot of money out of this mess.
And this means the system, as you said, doesn't really function. But this functioning is very productive for an elite of financial, I would say, super civilians.
Yeah. That's why I say that the system isn't a sign, but a tangential.
Yeah.
It goes into collapses regularly, and it is dented by energy from other places, from taxes, for example, etc.
We still have this idea that when there is crisis, you know, for example, we the media immediately going to find like, oh, is Karl Marx coming back? You know, you have this idea then there will be a left revolution when there is crisis. But the rich are better at crisis, you say.
Huh?
The rich people are better at playing crisis.
Because they are not bound to a state, they are not bound to a place, they are not bound to even national laws in a certain way. We have now a new class of feudal super civilians, which are characterized by unbound power in a certain way. But what is interesting, and you said Marx is coming back. Don't forget that 2008, a complete Marxist thesis was fulfilled or was actualized. The thesis that the modern stage of capitalism, which is financial capitalism, tends or has a tendency to socialization. And what happened in 2008, that all the banks socialized themselves. And it were the states who had much, had a lot of, how to say it in English, a lot of, made a lot of efforts to re-privatize these banks. This was our money. This was the money of the taxpayer. But the Marxist thesis was correct. Financial capitalism has a tendency towards socialization. And we have the strange tendency to re-privatize this capital. And this was the effect and the restart after 2008.
But I still have the same question. What could be an alternative? Let me ask it like this. Because these movies are really cynical. Actually, what we have been talking about, like real economics, you know, how it really functions, can also make very cynical. Because, okay, then you understand completely how it really works, not with invisible hands, equilibrium, stuff like that. You understand how it really works, but it's not really beautiful what you see. So I would like to finish this and then go to questions from the public. What have you seen the last 5 years? Give one example of not something cynical, but a positive example, like you think like that could be a nice, good alternative. What has inspired you during the last 5 years instead of all these hedge funds, investment funds who only became richer? First or you first?
This was the creation of a network, an international network, which has the wonderful title Network for Non- or Post-Autistic Economics.
It was about 2000 or 2001
yes,
French.
And this is something it's quite optimistic.
Mm-hmm. Because they wanted a different kind of economics. Huh?
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. And you, Thomas?
You know, I would now play a little bit of an advocate. We should really not go into extremes here. You know, this principle, winner takes it all, is not something that we invented. It's a song from ABBA. you know.
It's good to remember.
And that we should remember that even, and this song is about human relationship. I think that, of course, the meaning of these songs is difficult to decipher, but it seems to me that it's a relationship that goes break up. Well, but you also see this in sports, you see this in art, the winner takes it all. I mean, there's so many, 99% artists are thriving artists, and there's 1% that are extremely filthy rich artists, overpriced, I think. You see the same thing in pop music or in any music. 99% of the people are playing really good music, maybe perhaps better than U2. But it's the U2, the 1%, or maybe even 1% of the 1%. So maybe we should also do Occupy art, Occupy galleries, because you see the same principle at work in these completely remote fields or dancing. Take the example of Black Swan, if you've seen the movie. There you see a very, very dark side. It doesn't really happen in banking that you need to have sexual intercourse with somebody to be promoted. Whereas if we were to take the... even Wolf of Wall Street doesn't present the world in such colors. But if I was to take the Black Swan movie about the dancer as seriously as we are now elaborating on the Wolf of Wall Street, then these dancers had to actually have sexual relationship with whatever the choreographers in order to be actually placed in. Or take the movie Pianist, where there's this vicious, completely unfair competition with, you know, the glass. So this, I think, again, perhaps we are not criticizing, and this is my main criticism of Marxian criticism. In many cases where Marx criticizes capitalism, he in fact is criticizing human condition. It is a human tendency to overpower other people. This has always happened in feudalism, and it's always happened legally.
So ABBA was more right than Marx?
Always. I come from Czech Republic. Where I come from, we hate Marx, you know, because we have seen the realpolitik of what tried to be the cure of capitalism, and it ended up in completely disgusting. So I was actually quite unhappy with the research of Marxism, because we've done it. There's not a single one historical example where Marxism was in any way successful. Not a single country. Look at what happened East, West Germany. Look at what happened North, South Korea. You will say you can't really compare this. But in one way, this is, and I will end this question.
This will lead to the next 2 hours, so
of course.
Be careful.
The problem is, this is why Marxism or communism won in my country and in other countries as well, because the comparison was intellectually illicit. What we did and what we're also doing today is that we are comparing a real situation of real capitalism of 21st century with an ideal. So, of course, real capitalism will always look minor to ideal communism. But you can't do this. This is intellectually, it even has a name, but I can't think of it. You should compare real to real. So fine, give me another system that's actually working, and then let's talk. Or we compare ideal communism with ideal capitalism. And those are two fair comparisons. Now, every intellectual debate is, by definition, this. We take the real situation and we fantasize an ideal situation. Now, let's take, the question was, is there a better functioning system?
Oh, no, actually not.
So
it was a bit more more basic. Just, do you see some kind of little alternatives? It can be really small.
Okay. Did you know? See some little hope in the
even
last
somebody
few
who gave you a free lunch this afternoon could also count.
Outside Czech Republic.
And then afterwards we discuss the revolution.
Let's take the most, I would say, brilliant and most creative and most outspoken philosopher of the left, which Slavoj Žižek. You ask him, do you have an idea? And he says, no, I don't. And he even says this quite frequently, it is outside of the fantasy You know, he says this quite often, it is easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism. It is not even in the realm of our fantasy to think that way, with which I agree, but whose fault is it if not the people on the left? You're the ones who are supposed to come up with bright, bright new, you know, models and ideas, and these are simply non-existing. Okay, so do I see some hope? Actually, I start with my thesis that, well, we had crises during the communism as well. These crises were different. Let me say it this way. I don't think this is a crisis of capitalism per se. I think this is a crisis of growth capitalism. Because if the system would grow, we wouldn't have these complaints. It's a little bit like, I don't know how to do this really briefly, because this is always the problem.
Just try.
So let's imagine there is four beers, no. Three people sitting around the table, only two glasses of wine. How shall we distribute the wealth? Yeah, let's imagine that you also want it, you know. How shall we do this? Should the most academically respected person have it? Or should I, as an alcoholic, you know, have it? Or should you, as a host, have it? Or if the lady would be, should the one who came first have it? Should the richest have it? Or should we perhaps share it? There are, again, so many different levels of justice. When you come to a shop, the first comes, first serve. When you talk about new technology, the richest gets the first. When you come about hospital, the one who needs the treatment gets it first. Da-da-da-da-da. We, again, live in a society where we have layers and layers of justice completely contrary to each other, but because of cultural context, we understand that. The problem of distribution of wealth has been solved all the way till now that a magical third beer, see, I come from Czech Republic. A magical glass of wine suddenly magically appears on the table, problem solved.
Yeah.
This is an allegory on GDP growth. We don't have to so rigorously think about the division of the cake if the cake is getting larger. So even you, who gets the smallest amount of cake, is actually happy because it's still bigger than last week. The problem of, and so far so good, so I would even say that we as philosophers, theologians, sociologists, politicians have been bribed by growth in not really solving the problem of distribution of wealth that we create together.
Yeah, yeah. But then we are in Greece, two glasses of wine disappear.
And the
what do we do?
And the problem, the only, I'm overdoing this a little bit just for the lack of time. The only problem of today is that suddenly the third glass didn't appear. And we're going, oh my God, what have we been thinking? But this is not the fault of economists. So of course, it depends who you ask. If you ask an economist who should have the two glasses of wine, it's simple, let's auction it. I mean, economists will never, ever tell you anything else. If you ask a guy who does the protocol, he will say the most respected person should have both.
Thanks. Good idea.
If you ask a doctor, he will say nothing for Sedláček, he's already had enough. You know? So it really depends who you ask. So don't ask an economist. You know?
Yeah, he just took the last bit.
Yeah, so you see.
Cheers.
Don't ask a barber if you need a haircut.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's if you agree, it's a good time to go to the public, and if somebody would like to ask a question
or answer a question,
well, that would be nice,
a novelty.
Difference.
Well,
there comes a microphone, I think. Yeah.
I would like to discuss with you, it's more a risk management model. If you look back in history, we see all these capitalist crises. I've concluded, I've studied all kinds of economics, Marx, Austrian economics, etc. My conclusion is that we've never found a way to organize our monetary system properly. And I think a very good idea is actually to introduce a system whereby you introduce your money. So your money creation is just as is now happening in the banking system. You borrow it into existence, but it, you do not charge the interest on it. So, for example, a person can borrow to buy a house, a mortgage, but you can only borrow for the replacement value of this house, and it is created out of thin air. There is no interest charge on it. And this, the money, the person is paying back the money, and this is aligned with the depreciation rate of the asset purchased. So, and then the money is withdrawn from circulation again. So in this way, you always have money that is valued against the asset purchased. And so you have a stable, non-inflationary currency.
In a certain way, you are right. You are right, but this system does exist. You know that the whole Islamic world wasn't touched by the crisis, and what you described is exactly the credit system of the Islamic world. And it's very interesting to see that there is a new superpower coming from the Islamic states, which exactly experiment with this system of giving credits without interest. And I think I have the fear that this wouldn't be accustomed to our system, Christian system of taking interest. But this system is real. This is the system of Arabic states.
I agree with you that the problem is in interest rates. I mean, this is something that we have neglected. We don't know what interest rate is. Just because we can calculate it does not mean that we understand it. Let me share a nice joke from communist regime. There was one teacher of Marxism-Leninism comes to another teacher of Marxism-Leninism and says, you know, I've been teaching this for 20 years and I still don't understand it. And this other person says, well, you know, take a bottle of wine that's not empty and come to my place on a Friday evening and I will explain it to you. And this second person says, you idiot, I can explain it too, but I don't understand it. and so we can explain it, but we don't understand it. Then we should not make an equal sign between the two. Interest rate is, so for example, we cannot calculate interest rate till today. If we could, Greek collapse would be business as usual, because we've lended as banks to hundreds of companies over hundreds of years, exactly the whole risk model of the banking system, or the whole point of interest rate, or the risk component of the interest rate is exactly to shield against bankruptcies. That's what interest rate is about. So when the interest rate, when one bankruptcy happens, the whole system collapses. So what has happened is the uncertainty has moved from an individual lend bank sovereign relationship to a third party, which is the government. So that's why the banks don't collapse, the system collapses. The pecking order is also different. You notice that if a bank is about to collapse in a country, that country rather goes bankrupt than to allow its bank or banks go bankrupt. The food chain is different than this happened in Ireland, for example. But to answer a question, I think, okay, look, capitalism is changing. Capitalism 20 years ago was completely different from what it is today, and it will be different, and it will be, I hope, better 20 years from now. But I still think that these changes should be made within private ownership of capital. I don't see any bright idea outside of it. Or to put it in a more radical term, everybody is perfectly fine to establish a kibbutz, where you grow your own vegetables, where you don't use money, where you don't use banks, where you don't use cell phones, and I would even say that the society would applaud you for doing that. I think you'd have a lot of media attention. I think this would be an extremely interesting and honorable article for you to do. So there is no really sort of limits on that, which is exactly different from communism. Communism did not allow capitalist experiments. Simply not. So these systems are even not even on the same level. So this was the debate that I had with David Graeber, who said, we talked about the system being a zombie, non-functional, da-di-da-di-da, it's not perfect. Absolutely nobody doubts that it's not perfect. It's unfair. His solution was, we should kill the zombie, destroy the system, and come up with a new, completely new system via the means of revolution. I think Žižek, in between the lines, is suggesting something same. If you've seen his last movie, it also ends with a revolution. I would be very, very, very careful. I'd rather be sort of on Schumpeter's side with evolutionary economics trying to improve. Take ecology, for example. 20 years ago, it was a laughingstock. I mean, come on, those were, you know, 20 years ago, there were some radical eco-terrorists that were hanging themselves from the whales. Today, it is a serious economic and political reality with about what we no longer laugh. And I think these things, it's our system, and we are, and here I agree with Marx, the institutions are ours, and we should be responsible for these institutions to reflect the way we feel, but I would not be as radical as to sort of, I would be very much afraid if we started flirting with the idea of Marxism.
Did Joseph do that? Or?
No. Just, I don't think anybody suggests that, but just to make this clear that I think our advances need to be one step at a time, trial and error.
May I add one remark to the question? One last remark. I think the consequence of your question is money or currency or something like liquidity, is this a private or common good, public good? And I think the consequence of your question is, finally, currencies, money, and liquidity is a public good and cannot only be dealt in private hands. And this would be a big step to redefine something like money or currency or the value of currency as a public good. And now we assist in a situation where currencies, even currencies, and the value of currencies are privatized by derivative by financialization, by derivative markets, etc. And I think this is one of the core conflicts in this financial economy. Redefine something like currency as a public good.
Exactly, if I may say so, that is exactly the point that I'm trying to make. Mm. And in a lot of ways, it's a small change relatively. And also, it leaves capitalism as it is.
Yeah, yeah.
There is still a role for banks, so it's not like there are no more banks. Mm. It's just no more interest on the money creation. So creating a non-inflationary currency. Mm. And for corporate financing, etc., there are still banks required.
But what could happen under our mentality, and here I agree absolutely, probably a shadow market would develop, I think. If we still keep the mentality and we ban it, or somehow, it would be quite likely that shadow, like we had in the medieval times, when interest rates were banned, it was a shadow sort of.
I propose that we make a vote on this proposal at the end of the meeting, and we first go to another question. See here, Franz, somebody.
Do we still have some wine?
That's a good question.
No answer, come. No,
okay.
Well, I'm a theologian studying economy, and if I was to preach tomorrow about this subject, then I would be very impressed by the criticism, but I would be reluctant to tell the people about what new myths do we need for an economy that functions.
Yeah.
So I would like some enrichment on that, on new myths or new symbols that work.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
But isn't that same in Christianity?
What is?
Well, our behavior is, you know, strange, mm-hmm. but what's the positive solution to changing our behavior, this is an empty set in Christianity when it comes to real application. We have, of course, the salvation and, you know, the change of heart, mm-hmm. but also Christianity is also quite very 99% criticism and 1% on positive solution, mm-hmm. except for, you know, divine reliance on salvation.
Yeah. And what's the 1%?
The 1% is, you know, pray for the change of heart.
If we're not homo economicus, if we're more than that, then what new symbols can we invent to make people more happy about functioning in this economy?
You describe in your a whole chapter on Christianity, and you describe a whole social system, actually an early welfare system that the Bible proposes.
Well, Christianity never. In my understanding, you must be much more proficient in this. When Christianity started institutionalizing, they were expecting the end of times to come, so they never really had a whole society. Suggestion. They lived in the house of Priscilla. They had sort of communism, communitarianism, maybe to dock the negative word. But that was never suggested for the whole society.
But my question is not a plea for Christianity. It's just a metaphor for, because I want to know more about not why the system that we have now is not functioning. I want to know a little bit more about alternatives or about alternative views on an economy that does work or that invites people to join in instead of being pushed to the side and making the rich richer.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I understand the question. I just don't know. And this I think is this. We have not. Correct me if I'm wrong. We have not invented. We know we have the task. We want to change the religion. We can no longer believe what we believed. We need reformation. We even need repentance, and we are going through repentance. We want to metanoia. We want to change our ways. We know we did something wrong. We're not exactly sure what it was, but please, the prayer of today is, "System, forgive us." For we do not know what we are doing.
But can I?
On
can
everyday
I,
basis, I live in a bank. Sorry, I live. I work in a bank. we use billions of money every single day. We don't know what money is. We use interest every single second. We use interest to calculate wages. We do not know what interest rate is. Thank you
so much.
And there is a task for new religion or new belief in economics.
What a miracle.
And I'm okay, let me put it in this way. I'm trying to work on it. I'm only 37.
I would like to ask a question continuing on this. For the last year, almost every a bit alternative economist I spoke to proposed the same thing, namely, well, they propose many things, but one of the constantly coming back is the jubilee, which you also describe.
What's the jubilee?
So the debt forgiving.
Okay, jokes aside, of course, I have many practical small step suggestions
in my
book.
It's quite a
banning fiscal policy. What we did to monetary policy, de-etatize it. You know, politicians can no longer print as much money as he wishes, but he can still do fiscal policy as he or she wishes. The Euro Jubilee is a good idea. There are many, many things, but they're all only very small steps towards improvement. There is not one single bullet that works. And this is wonderful, what you could see in the middle of the crisis. Suddenly, the politicians ask economists, okay, tell us what to do, and the only thing that the economists did was repeat what OECD has been publishing for 60 years.
Mm. Yeah, but
you use the word improvement, so you have an idea of what direction it should go.
Your question was what stories could be told now?
Yeah.
And I think it's very interesting that from the 50s up to the 80s, we talked about this afternoon, we had a sort of social contract that capitalism functioned only in cooperation with the welfare state. Capitalism only can survive if the welfare state minimizes conflicts, etc. So if a social structure is guaranteed, if a certain minimizing of fallout, social fallout is guaranteed, capitalism will survive. This was a social contract, and this social contract was broken in the 80s. In the 80s, capitalism suddenly realized that new tolerance of misery doesn't endanger capitalism. 14% of United States population is living by food stamps. No problem for capitalism in United States. Greece or Romania or whatever is not really a danger for the capitalist system in Europe. So this social contract is broken, and I think the stories you should tell in preachers or whatever is the upcoming of a new form and new figures and new phenomena of misery, simply misery. And this is these are the stories we have to tell now, and not the stories of success, not the stories of the success of the Homo economicus or of the Robinson, etc., but really try to find the stories of the miserable.
Defetishize economics. To me, economics is an important, it's one of the seven virtues, prudence. That's an important thing. Even in the New Testament, you don't build a house until you calculate. It's a stupid thing. But to me, growth is a priority number seven. Priority number one is justice. I think Psalm 137, I'm not sure, starts, lead me into the land of righteousness. This is a prayer that we don't pray. We want to be led into the land of growth, period. And so one thing, growth will not solve these problems. It second small little suggestion, why does China pay us for Microsoft intellectual property rights? And why don't we pay China for tea? Same thing. They've invented tea. Many people, I think, died on it until they found out that this is not a good thing to drink. And we stole their intellectual property, and we are trading it at marginal costs. Or another nice example of this, I think it was something I was thinking about from 2 weeks ago. You know, market is only price is only possible when we artificially create scarcity. So, for example, Microsoft products or any software is technically speaking a public good. But the only way we can charge for Microsoft or on any other products is that we artificially create scarcity, which we keep under the threat of violence. So if you make an illegitimate copy of whatever, violence will be exercised on you. Certain things are like this, Microsoft, for example, but yoga isn't, Chinese tea isn't, and if only these power structures would be remedied, then that flow of capital would go not westward, but eastward. Another, and I will end here, more radical suggestion, currency that would be born not in banks nor in governments, but from inside. So now don't laugh at me, but this is extremely over romantic and kitschy, but just imagine a mental exercise where smiles would be currency. Immediately the flow of capital would go into Africa. Because it's very easy to make an African child smile, very difficult to make a European brat smile.
This is very kitschy.
Yeah, this is extremely kitschy, but just a mental exercise, how profit-maximizing initiative would completely change direction. Because today's world, we're trying to feed the Fed. Not the poor, but the Fed. We're trying to feed the rich. And that's very difficult. But if smiles would be currency, everything else could be the same, and all the investments would go into the places where we would rightly feel they need to be the most.
I would like to go over to, because we have, I think, 7 minutes, so we can have two last questions.
The questions are not over the there. Problems, the answers are long.
Well, thank you for being here. professor in literature and someone who knows a lot about myths. I am very interested why we as citizens and as politicians and as editors of newspapers choose to follow the myth of economics. There are many myths in our society. There are many stories, religions, many stories. We can choose whatever story we want. Why do we choose the story of economy? Why do we choose the story of growth? Why? I don't know, because it leads us nowhere. It leads us from each other. There's no solidarity in capitalism. So why do we all follow that road? I don't understand. Why do politicians do it? Why do editors do it? Why do we all citizens not speak to each other and say we want to choose another road?
I think there's a very, very clear and very simple and even stupid answer, because this kind of economics and this kind of especially financial economics represents the most social power. And we always follow the idea of power. And this is reason why newspapers and politicians and governments follow this. We created, since the 17th century, we created a completely new power out of control. And this is this form of financial capitalism, which is not addicted to parliaments, not addicted to executive powers, etc. And we adore it. I think...
We don't.
I think...
So it doesn't give us anything except that
it's
a social myth.
It gives some people quite a lot of things.
And we are unhappy with this myth. We no longer believe it. We want a new religion, which is in the making. And I don't know that it has been successful. For example, my book is a mythology, my mythology that I created myself out of fun, and obviously some people like it. And every economist, every politician, if he's skillful, creates the archetypes and molds them into a story that he enjoys telling and people enjoy listening to. Mm. And this is, I think, the reason why we're not in politics, but why we write books, no?
Maybe. but perhaps there could be another answer. And this is something which is really close to our mental, our social, our psychic, intellectual organization. And this element is closely linked to the markets, to financial markets. I think it's very difficult for us to distance ourselves from the idea of competition. And we are formatted, we are disciplined, as competitive subjects. And I have the impression that this, the idea of competition is a sort of key of our behavior, a sort of key of our behavior in all respects, in friendships, in profession, professional relations, etc. I think if you make really a sort of research of our consciousness, I think it's very difficult to see where we don't function via competition. For this reason, I think this society functions so perfectly, because we are all competitive subjects in our roots in a certain way.
Another way to explain it, just very short.
You get the last words, but then I have to say now. Then we skip the last question.
Oh no. In that case, I'd rather have the question.
Oh, okay. If there is another question, there, completely in the back.
Some people say microphone that demand is the product of envy, and I must say that while I was looking at you, drinking your first bottle of wine, I developed certain feelings of envy. And when you opened the second bottle of wine and discussed about the distribution between you three of the second bottle of wine,
I must say that my envy
grew. In short, I'd like a bottle too.
I suggest we go into a pub after this is over. And I will invite you for a nice little glass of wine. I'm sorry, this is really improper. Desire does not want to be fulfilled. Desire wants to be replicated in a new one. You can see this. Why are we not satisfied? Because our LCDs are not 2 inches larger. Of course, the most scary image is that we already live in the most beautiful society. I think this. I don't know. Our desires will never, ever be satisfied. I talked about even in a situation of perfect equality, we will invent immediately symbolic inequality. I just think, and I think maybe this is the lesson that we can learn from Christianity or other religions, that good, we should be actually happy, content with good. This is the meaning to me of the fourth commandment. The first practical commandment of the Ten Commandment is not the thou shall not fuck around commandment. It's thou shall not work all the time commandment. Thou shall not change the reality all the time. Thou shall not improve reality all the time. And we should also be able to say enough. We don't need the system to be better. We don't need more. Because on the seventh day, as we know, God rested because he was done. How many of us think of rest in that way? I had a friend and we introduced each other when we met and then, you know, how, what's your name, blah, 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 what do you do? And he said, nothing, I'm done.
let me ask at one last point. I must confess, and this is really a confession, it is not really amusement to sit here being in the light and talking nonsense or whatever. This is not really amusing. What I'm interested in situations like this, and even in a question, and even the last question you asked, I have the impression that this topics, economics, financial markets, etc., is the base of new forms of solidarity or thinking together in a certain way. This is the only reason why I'm sitting here. Not to promote the book or whatever, but I had the impression that there is a certain general interest, as Marx would, general intellect, as Marx would say it, that different people from all different kinds of social horizons can work together to create a new social intelligence. Even drinking wine here is an intellectual experience for me to create another form of intellectual solidarity in a certain way.
We would not have this debate 7 years ago.
No, not
this
at all.
This topic would never attract this much attention, political attention, and I think this, we should never despise, everything starts with the word. I mean, this building was a word, this bottle of wine, this cell phone, this phone was a word in the beginning, and then later it materialized, emancipated itself in the real world. And I really think, listening to the debates, that it actually is going in the right direction. We don't know the final, you know, windows, but it's definitely something, like I used the example of the green philosophy. 20 years ago, it was a laughable thing. We washed our cars in rivers. It was normal. Why not? You know, nobody does this anymore.
I think these are great final words. You both, thank you for that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And that's some more wine.